and strife.
My heart is your temple.
Live inside.
Lord, you are the air I breathe. You
keep me alive.
Lord, I need your clothes. Please stay around. Lord, you're like the river that
never runs dry.
My heart is your temple.
Live inside.
Lord, you are the air I breathe. You
keep me alive.
Lord, I need your clothes. Please stay around. Lord, I need your clothes. Please stay around. Lord, I need your clothes. Please
stay around.
So you won't ever give up on me. And all that I have will never be enough to show you how much I
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. The Bible said, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. So if you're breathing this morning, we ought to lift our hands, stand to our feet, and give the Lord a hand clap of praise in the house of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I shall rejoice and be glad. Doesn't matter how you feel, we worship him today. We magnify him. We glorify him today. He alone is worthy of the glory, the honor, and the praise. His name is Jehovah Jireh, the God that provided. His name is Jehovah Shalom, the God that gives us peace. His name alone is worthy of the glory, the honor, and the praise. The Bible said, if my people that are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and will heal their land. Let's pray. Amen.
Hallelujah. He's most worthy of our praise. We have this treasure in earthen vessel, that the excellency might be of God and not of us. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. Father Almighty, we thank you. You said those that worship you must do so in truth and in spirit. For the Lord desires such to worship him. Father, we're committing each and every one of us as your body. Hallelujah. That the Holy Spirit will be present today to minister to you on our behalf, our temples, our bodies, our mouth, our eyes, our feet, our comportment, everything about us, everything that is glorious in us should praise the Lord. In our singing, in the preaching, in our greeting of one another, let us do all in the name of Jesus, giving glory and thanks to God through him. Father, we thank you. In those areas where we have failed repeatedly, we pray, Lord, that a word will be spoken today. Hallelujah. That will revive us again where we may have lost the vision. Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit, by your word, where our bodies may be ailing, we pray that the healing virtue of the Holy Spirit, by your stripes we will be healed, just by your word. We thank you, Lord, for answered prayer. For in Jesus' name I have prayed. Amen.
Good morning, VLC. Anybody excited about being in the house of the Lord this morning? Come on, are you excited to really give God worship and praise this morning? I don't know about you, but I love being in the presence of the Lord. David said, in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And at his right hand, there are what? Pleasures forevermore. So I already feel the presence of the Lord here. Anybody feel the presence of the Lord here? It says, the presence of the Lord is here. The presence of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The presence of the Lord is here. Oh, the presence of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here. I feel it. The Spirit of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is here. And it says the power of the Lord is here. Anybody need God's power? The power of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The power of the Lord is here. Oh, the power. Oh yeah, I hear that hand clapping. Come on. Let's sing this BLC. Here we go. 1, 2, the Spirit. Come on.
The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Say that, Spirit of the Lord.
The Spirit of the Lord is here.
I feel it. I feel
it in the atmosphere.
Come on, do it.
The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Clap those hands. Let's go up a little higher. Let's do the presence of the Lord right here. Come on, say the presence.
The presence of the Lord is here.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
In the atmosphere.
The presence of the Lord.
The presence of the Lord is here.
Oh, the presence of the Lord. Let's go up a little higher. Oh, the power of the Lord. Come on, say it.
The power of the Lord is here.
The power of the Lord.
The power of the Lord is here.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
The power of the Lord.
The power of the Lord is here.
Oh,
the power of the Lord
is here.
Is here.
Let's lift it up right here, everybody. Come on, say it.
Everybody blow the trumpet.
Come on, sound the alarm, because the Lord, come on, say,
because the Lord is in the temple, let everybody bow.
Let all the people, come on, say,
let all the people praise him now, the Lord.
He's here.
He's here.
That's it, come on, clap those in. Let's go up a little higher. Here we go right here. Come on, tell somebody, say a blessing. Come on, say,
a blessing from the Lord is here.
Come on, point to your neighbor and tell them, say,
the blessing from the Lord is here.
I feel it in the atmosphere.
In the atmosphere.
A blessing from the
Lord. From the Lord is here.
Oh, Lord. Lord, come on, say it.
Because the Lord is in the temple, let everybody bow.
Bow right where you are. Come on, let all.
Let all the people praise him now, the Lord.
Say that, the Lord.
The Lord.
Do it one more time. The Lord.
The Lord.
Shout it out. He is here.
He's here.
Hey.
Lord, and I'm gonna get my blessing.
Lift it up to pray now, come on.
I can feel the presence of the Lord.
Let's check it out right here, church. So come and enter in and cast your cares on him. He'll open up a window and pour you out a blessing. Cause when the Lord steps in, he brings everything you need. Healing, power, and victory. Said it's all up to you. Whatever you need him to do, just trust him and believe it and receive it by faith. Say, oh, come on. And I'm gonna get it. Anybody came to get your blessing this morning? Come on, say it. Feel the presence. And I'm gonna get it. Hey, come on, tell your neighbor, say, I can feel the presence. And I'm gonna get it, yeah. I can, yeah. And I'm gonna get it. Now do me a favor, everybody, clap your hands. Come on, clap those hands. When you clapping, you confusing the enemy. He don't know why you clapping. Clap your hands. Now we're gonna do it one last time. Come on, sing it right here. Oh, I can feel the presence. And I'm gonna get it. Yeah. One more time, say, feel the presence. Now shout real big, the presence of the Lord right here. The presence of the Lord is here. Oh. Somebody give God praise. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on, anybody feel the presence? We thank you, Father. And by your presence is here, you deserve our worship. You deserve our praise. Come on, anybody, you know that the Lord deserves your worship, that the Lord deserves your praise. Hallelujah. Come on, just tell your Father, say, you deserve it. Everything that I have, Lord, you deserve it. Yes, you do. Hallelujah. Come on, just lift those hands all over the building.
We love you, Lord. You deserve it. Yeah. Oh, Lord. You deserve it. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you.
Okay. Let your Father hear you. Come on. Come on, tell him why. Come on, sing it, church. Do it together.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah
belongs to you. Oh, my hallelujah
yeah.
Belongs to you.
That's the highest praise I can give to you. Hallelujah.
My hallelujah.
Yeah. I lift my hand and say, you deserve it. You deserve it. Everything I have, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Can we all clap our hands and receive Naya at the time, at this time?
Yeah. Amen. Not by might, not by power, but by your spirit, Lord. Amen. As that young lady was dancing and she was spinning around, I could feel the glory of the Lord spinning in this place. In Zechariah 4:6, that's what the angel said to him. He said, the word of the Lord came to Zerubbabel. He says, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. And we stand in awe of the Almighty, the true and the living God. And he is worthy to be praised. And the whole earth is filled with his glory. And it is not by our own power, not by our own works or by our own might, but by his spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. I feel the power and the presence of God in this place today. Hallelujah. Oh. Nothing like it. Amen. Praise God. Amen. It's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord this morning. We'd like to welcome everybody to Victorious Life Church. Those of us watching online, welcome, welcome, welcome. If you're here today for the very first time, we'd like to take this time to honor you and to welcome you to Victorious Life Church. I'm going to ask if you would please raise your hands and raise it high, and we would like to acknowledge you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Amen. Amen. Welcome. Welcome. Amen. First-time visitors all over the house today. For our first-time visitors, we ask if you would please leave your hand raised until our ushers hand you a visitor's card. And we ask if you would please fill out that visitor's card. And at the end of the service, in the foyer area by the front exit doors to your left, there's the guest central desk. You can turn that card in. If you have any questions about our church, we'd be more than happy to answer those questions. And we also have a special gift for you. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Next, we'll have a video announcements, then followed by the scripture reading from Brother Ed Corum, and then we'll prepare hearts and minds to worship the Lord our God through our giving of the tithe and the offering, and then we'll come with our final praise song. Amen.
October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and according to health experts, 1 in 8 women will be diagnosed with breast cancer in their lifetime. In today's Living Well, our Taylor Holt learns the importance of early detection and how women can stay on top of their health.
I cannot stress this enough, that early detection saves lives.
SSM Health Breast Imaging Specialist Dr. Cheryl Herman says time is of the essence.
As far as demographics, the incidence of breast cancer is the same in all women, particularly now we're saying black women and white women. However, even though the incidence is the same, black women are 42% more likely to die from breast cancer.
And it's affecting younger women too, prior to age 40. She says in many women who get breast cancer earlier, it tends to be more aggressive, so you want to catch it early.
There are women who are high risk. And how do you determine that? You have a discussion with your primary care clinician. So we recommend that all women should have this discussion with their clinician at the age of 25. So that sounds early, but there are women that need to be screened prior to age 40.
An average risk woman should start screening at age 40 and continue every other year until 74. For younger women, self-breast exams in your 20s should lead up to your first mammogram.
Many times we don't feel or see anything, and that's why mammography is fantastic. It's still the main gold standard for catching breast cancer.
So as far as prevention,
I mean, the main things are lifestyle, no smoking, decreased or no drinking, healthy weight, healthy diet, exercise. And if you feel something that is unusual for you, then you go in and let your physician or clinician know.
Give Jesus a hand clap of praise in the house. Hallelujah. Is any good this morning? Hallelujah. Is anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Is anybody glad your neighbor's in the house? Amen. Why don't you turn to your neighbor real quick, tell him I'm glad to see you. Glory to God. We welcome all of you this morning to Victorious Life Church, and we're thankful to God for your presence. Thank God for what he's doing among us and how he's blessing us. Amen. You're looking good this morning. Amen. And we give him praise. This time we're going to have a baby dedication. I'm going to ask the parents, godparents of Renea, is it Renea? All right, Lang. They would come forward at this time. Welcome in. Praise the Lord. Let's bow our heads. Gracious Heavenly Father, we bless you today. We give you praise. For you indeed are the giver of life. Thank you for this gift. You've loaned this earth. Form of Renea Lang. So we pause to commit, dedicate this child to you. Let your presence, your glory be upon us. Let the gravity and power of this moment be real to us now. Be glorified in this moment. Bless these parents, godparents, grandparents, and be with them. Grant us wisdom that this child would be a child that will glorify your name. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Napoleon once said, let France have good parents, and she will have good sons. It was Charles Spurgeon, the famous preacher, who declared that he had two reasons why he was what he was. One was the truth that he preached, and he said the second was his parents. Joshua, God's general, said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The family is indeed a divine institution ordained of God in the beginning of time. Children are a heritage of God and are committed to their parents for care, protection, and training. Therefore, it is important that all parents recognize their obligation and responsibility to God in this manner. It was Moses' mother who trained her child after she gave him to God. It was Hannah who recognized that her child was Jehovah's because she received him as from God. She believed that God could do more for him and through him than she could do. So she gave him back to God while he was still young and tender. The son's name actually means Samuel, which means he was asked of God because he prayed and God granted her request. The New Testament says that Mary brought the young child to Jesus, to the temple. And now these parents today come and recognize the sacredness of their charge and now bring their child back to God. To these parents, I want to charge you today. If you'll answer to the following with, we do. In the sight of God and in the presence of these witnesses, do you promise to bring up this child to respect God? Do you promise to seek to lead her to accept Jesus as her Lord and Savior at a young age? Do you promise as far as that which lies within you to set before her examples of godly and consistent Christian lives? Let us bow our heads. Would you stretch your hand toward this way? Father, I thank you for this bundle of joy that I hold in my hand. I thank you for the gift of this, your daughter. Father, we pray for her today. We ask that your presence, your anointing, your power would be upon her, even at a young age. I pray a covering of protection around her and her parents, that you would grant them, dear God, your grace. Bless her in every way. May she impact this world for your glory and for your honor. Be with us now and grant these parents wisdom as they guide her. And we will give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. This family, we want to present you with a few gifts from our church, Victorious Life. To my brother, I give you this red rose. Thank you. It is symbolic. Red is symbolic of the blood of Christ. It is symbolic of your duty as a father to provide protection for your children. The children of Israel were in bondage for 400 years. A death angel would go through the land as a plague. Moses was instructed to take the blood of a spotless lamb and place it upon the doorhouse. And when the death angel saw the blood, he passed over. That red, that blood was protection. That is your duty. And I charge you today to this mother, I give you the pink rose. We're celebrating, of course, Breast Cancer Awareness Day, but also the symbolic of the love of a mother. And we pray that that love would continue to flow into the life of your daughter and your family. And to Renea, this is the white rose that represents purity. And we pray that God would keep her pure as she walks through this life to glorify God. We also would like to present to you this certificate. We ask that you would take this certificate and frame it, place it somewhere significant in your home so that when she comes of age, she'll see it, ask questions, and you will remind her of this day that she's been dedicated to the Lord. We pray God will be with you and strengthen you in the days to come. We are here for you and we love you. God bless you. This time we'll have our scripture reading, and then we'll receive our offering.
VLC. Morning. You know, before I get started, my wife reminded me that October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and that the second Sunday in October, which was last Sunday, is actually Pastor Appreciation Day. So we weren't here last week. I'd just like to take a minute to say to Bishop Lee and Lady Lee, that we appreciate you. We thank you for all that you do. We love you. I'll be reading from Genesis chapter 50, verses 16 through 26, and I'm reading the New King James Version. So they sent messengers to Joseph, saying, "Before your father died, he commanded, saying, 'Thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sin, for they did evil to you. Now please forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of your father.' And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also went and fell down before his face, and they said, 'Behold, we are your servants.' Joseph said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive. Now therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. So Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's household, and Joseph lived 110 years. Joseph saw Ephraim's children to the third generation. The children of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were also brought up on Joseph's knees. And Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land of which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. Amen.
Amen. No, I'm not going to preach. Amen. At this time, we're going to receive our offering as the ushers are coming. Hasn't God been good to you? Amen. We ought to give God the biggest praise that we can find. He's been faithful, God. Hallelujah. He's brought us from danger, seen and unseen. He's brought some of us back from death. I had a testimony this morning in the foyer. Brother Raymond is in the house, and he just testified about how he was on death's bed. Hallelujah. The doctors wanted to pull the plug, but he's here with a smile on his face this morning. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. What, look at, he's standing in the house of the Lord. What, 2 weeks ago, the doctor said there's nothing else we can do. Hallelujah. And here he is smiling because of the prayers of the righteous that have availed much. Hallelujah. Let's give God the biggest praise we can find. Hallelujah. He's a great, 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 great God. Hallelujah. And my praise belongs to him. It's my delight to give my offering. It's my delight to give my tithe today, because nobody can do what God has done. Hallelujah. So I want you to, those of you who have not yet reached a point of tithing, think about this. If God ever turned his back and said no, where would we be? Oh, but he's been generous and faithful. He's worthy of the 10%. He's more than worthy of the offering that goes with the 10%. Hallelujah, because he's going to do it again and again and again and again. Today it's Raymond. Tomorrow it might be me. Hallelujah. But do it again, Jesus. Do it again, Lord. Hallelujah. Do it for me. I will tithe my offering because I believe to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Come on and give your tithe today. God bless you.
Come on and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Is anybody glad that you're kept by the power of God? Amen. Thank God for his keeping power. Sometimes he keeps us when we don't want to be kept. But thank God for his keeping power. Can we express our appreciation to our choir? Amen. Sister Moore, for your direction, we appreciate you. Amen. For y'all young people, this is old school choir directing. Anybody remember back in the day? Oh yeah. So thank God. Amen. So blessed again to have all of you. Thank God. Is that Sister Rain that danced this morning? All right. God bless you. Let's give her a hand clap of appreciation. Which one? Naya. All right, Sister Naya, God bless you. What a wonderful, wonderful job. We're so proud of you. And may God continue to use you, amen, for his glory and for his honor. Let me remind you that our tickets to our Christmas celebration, our dinner theater, are on sale. They'll be on sale in the foyer after church, as well as you can go directly to our website to purchase as well. But you'll be part of that, and I believe God is going to bless you. You're also in the process of planning for our New Year's celebration. We're going to do something special for our New Year's Eve and New Year's celebration. Stay tuned. Amen. I believe it'll be a blessing to you. Let me say thank you for all of you for your expressions of appreciation. It's nice to be appreciated. So let me say thank you. Let me also say thank you for your prayers. Amen. Many of you have probably noticed that from time to time I've been struggling with some issues with my back and some nerve issues. We are working on getting better. But I am grateful because for this month I have been off, totally off of the pain medication, so God is good. There have been times where I had to actually take medication right there, sitting and waiting to come forward. So while I was in front of you, I was under the influence. So some of y'all, oh, that's what it is. That's what it is. Blame it on, say, it's the old song they have in the world, says blame it on the alcohol. Oh, anyway, I know y'all don't know nothing about that, so let me, y'all pray. Pastor, y'all pray. Genesis chapter 50, but let me say thank you for your prayers. Amen. We're getting better. Amen. A busy week this week. I was in Holly Hill, North Carolina. Went from there to Charlotte, North Carolina. Then I just got back from New York yesterday, day or Friday night. So it's been a busy week. But the more I do for the kingdom, the more energy I'm feeling. So thank you for your prayers. God is good. Genesis chapter 50. For the sake of time, we're going to go right to the 24th and 25th verse. It reads, and Joseph said unto his brethren, I die, and God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land unto the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you. Ye shall carry up my bones from hence. I want to continue speaking to you as we have come to the concluding message of our series entitled The Joseph Journey. Of course, the Joseph Journey is profound because there are parts of that journey that all of us can relate to. Can I get a witness in the house? So today we have come to the conclusion of this, and we're going to focus our attention on the command that Joseph gave to his family. And I want to use for a title this morning, Don't Bury Me Here. Turn to somebody and tell them, don't bury me here. Let's pray. Thank you for your word today. Thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you, God, that we are just strangers passing through. Place destiny and consciousness in our spirit through the power of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. When Heaven's Headquarters downloaded this title into my spirit, it immediately caused me to ponder the question of where I would want to be buried should the Lord Jesus not return to rapture the church. You see, this calling of ministry, it has caused us to relocate and live in so many places that it caused me to entertain the question of where I would like my final resting place to be. Now understand that I'm not trying to be morbid this morning. I'm not trying to drop any hints or suggest that my time is coming to an end. So don't any of y'all call the insurance company or plan to raid my office just yet. Because I do believe that God is not through with me yet. However, the name of this sermon, it had me thinking about where the headstone that will mark the place of my burial might be. I mean, will it be in my hometown, the birthplace of basketball, and the home of the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame, known as Springfield, Massachusetts? Will it be in the city of Providence in the ocean state of Rhode Island where I pastored my first church? Where will it be in the red clay hills of Tennessee, the city of Cleveland, where the Church of God International Headquarters is located? Maybe the sunshine state of Florida, the free state of Maryland, the island of Bermuda, or perhaps right here in the peach state of Georgia where I presently serve. You see, I thought about this because where one is buried is a significant thing to so many people. According to statistics, people spend thousands of dollars to purchase plots of land and to make pre-arrangements. In 2015, it was noted that 69% of adults over the age of 40 indicated that they would prefer to prearrange their own service. However, only 17% had actually made arrangements. 60% of those who have prearranged their services have prepaid for some or all of them. And know that as a pastor, I have officiated over more funerals than I can count. And I have seen and heard, even through media, some of the strangest requests and actions at burial services. I witnessed people having their ashes scattered over the land and thrown into the sea or the ocean. I have seen people pouring liquor on caskets on behalf of the homies. People dropping expensive jewelry, watches, and wedding bands, which made me want to do a U-turn on my way out of the cemetery. And then there is my all-time favorite, Chicago's gangster, Willie the Wimp Stokes. Buried in his custom-designed casket made to resemble a Cadillac Seville. At his viewing, he was propped up in a coffin with his hands on the steering wheel. The casket had functioning headlights and taillights that blinked, white wall tires, a windshield, and vanity license plate that read Wimp, which was Stokes' nickname. He wore a flaming red suit, a jaunty gray hat, and diamond rings, and had several $100 bills stuck out from between his fingers. Guess the brother just didn't want to wait in line when he got to hell. You know, he just said, let me just, you know, I'm just going to Gonna take the Hell Express, you know, just make sure that everybody know. I'm sorry, let me, okay. So it says in the minds of human beings, where and how one is buried is extremely significant. But not only is the place of our burial important to us in the time in which we are living, burial was also a matter of great importance in the Word of God. In the Old Testament, we find the story of Abraham's negotiation to purchase a cave for his wife Sarah's burial, amen, being told in detail in Genesis chapter 23. Graves were sometimes marked with pillars, according to Genesis 35 and 20, and 2 Kings 23 and 17. The places where Old Testament figures were buried were known for generations to come and were even adorned by loved ones. And for a person to not receive a proper burial, it was actually a matter of great shame. Because in the Old Testament, one's burial served to bind the dead to their ancestors, which is why we often hear the biblical phrase describing death with expressions of he was gathered to his people or he rested with his fathers. And burial is what Joseph had in mind as we come to our chosen text as he is approaching the end of his journey. This amazing man of God has now reached a point in which he is facing what Dr. Martin Luther King called life's most common denominator, that thing called death. This man, whose life journey has been an epic tale of survival and resilience, as he has survived the pity of the pit, the false accusations of Potiphar's house, the pain of the prison, and now he is in power in the palace. He has forgiven his brothers and has restored his family. And now he is gathering with them as he is sharing with him his final wishes concerning his own burial. He is now giving them prophetic instruction. As we find in verse 24, listen to what he said. And Joseph said to his brothers, I die, and God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land unto the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones from hence. He is now in second in command over Egypt. He has servants at his beck and call. He is living in a fine palace. He has silk robes and all of the fine linen of their day. He is riding around on a chariot that was produced by Rolls Royce and Bentley. But yet he says, when you bury me, as good as Egypt is right now, do not bury me here. Take my bones, carry them into the land of promise, which God swore to our favorite father Abraham. And today, I want to share with you the reasons why Joseph did this and why all of us must make up our mind that we will not be buried here. I want to share them with you in this message. The first thing, number one, and reason why we must not be buried here, don't bury me here, because I don't belong here. Turn to somebody, tell them I don't belong here. You see, as Christians, as believers, as members of the body of Christ, we need to understand that when we came to Jesus, we became kingdom citizens. So therefore, we must understand that we are actually in a transitional relationship with this world in which we live. We are strangers. We are foreigners. We are citizens with a temporary visa, not a permanent passport. Are y'all here? Yes. Dr. Miles Monroe said this about citizenship. He said that a citizen is someone who owes allegiance to a government and who is therefore entitled to receive protection from mistreatment and also to enjoy special rights and privileges that come with citizenship. So when we came to Jesus, we literally place our citizenship not on this earth, but in the kingdom of our Almighty God. So therefore, we are simply strangers who are passing through on our way to another place. Would you turn to somebody, tell them I'm just passing through. Yes, I'm just passing through. Amen. This world is not my home. My God, I am living here. But the truth of the matter is, I belong to a different kingdom. Glory to God. And this kingdom, it is not about a religion. It is not about a democracy, but it is a governing influence of a king over a territory, influencing that territory with his will, which forms the culture of the people. And it is all centered around our king. And who is our king? Jesus is my king. Would you touch somebody and tell them Jesus is our king? Yes, he is our king. Glory to God. So therefore, as I am walking through this walk on this earth, amen, everything I do, all that I say, my very conduct, my very behavior must be a reflection of the king in which I serve. Glory to God. You see, when you are a kingdom citizen, amen, your philosophies, amen, your ways of thinking must be governed by the laws and the principle on which the kingdom in which you belong. And oftentimes, when it comes to God's kingdom, those principles and ways of behavior are going to be in direct conflict and the opposite of the laws of this world. So therefore, there will be times when people will expect me to behave a certain way, where people would expect me to respond a certain way, when the norm would be to do this and do that. But no, we are kingdom citizens and we must be different. Oh, is this too old-fashioned for y'all this morning? Amen. You see, our thinking has to be different. Our philosophies must be different and kingdom related. Colossians 3:1, this is what he said. See then, since you have been risen with Christ, set your hearts or affection on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above and not on earthly things. In Romans chapter 12, this is what he said. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Glory to God. So I don't think like the world. I don't talk like the world. I don't behave like the world. I behave like a child of the king. Oh, my God. Touch somebody. Tell them I'm a king's kid. Oh, I'm a king's kid. I do business like a king's kid. I treat people like they belong to the king. I think like a king's kid. My attitude is kingly. I don't fight like they fight. I don't do what they do. Why? Because I'm a child of the king. Glory to God. If anybody asks you who I am, you just tell them I'm a child of God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. My behavior is that which belongs and behaves like I'm on my way through here and not permanently here. You see, one of the problems that we're having in the church is that we are behaving as though we want to be in and be accepted by this world. We want to be so close to the line that now the world is in the church and the church is in the world. We have become caught up in what we call worldliness. And I don't get nervous because I know back in the day when we talked about worldliness, all about jewelry and makeup and pants and all kinds of stuff, when the women could not do anything but wake up in the morning and say, let's see how bad I can look today and go about their business. But let me... But understand that worldliness is not about your outward appearance. Now, it will affect what you put on. Are y'all hearing me? Uh-huh. Yeah. But worldliness is all about thinking and behaving. It is thinking and behaving like unbelievers think and behave. It is behaving like this world is all there is to it and that there is nothing beyond here. But listen to what Paul said to the church in Ephesians, verse 4, chapter 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the name of the Lord, let ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of your mind. And then in verse 22, he said that ye put off concerning your former manner of living the old man, which is corrupt according to deceitful lusts. James 4:4, know ye not that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore will be a friend of this world is an enemy of God. Can I preach this morning? Ephesians 2:2-3, wherein in times past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that while now worketh in the children of disobedience. Among those also we had all manner of living in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. My God, that is how we used to walk. That is how we used to live. That is how we used to feel. Amen. We wanted to be part of the world. We wanted to be loved by the world. But when we came to Jesus and got our new passport, glory to God, we turned to this world in the words of the song and said, goodbye, world, I'll stay no longer with you. Glory to God, I'm a stranger and I'm passing through. I'm on my way to another place and I'm going to be united with my King. And that's what I love about Joseph. He reigned over Egypt, but yet he walked and godly authority. Let me pause here. Just because we're strangers passing through, that doesn't mean that we gotta wait till we get to heaven to enjoy some blessings. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, God wanna bless you right now. Right down here. Amen. Don't get me wrong. God's not saying you got to wait till you get to heaven. My God, but he wants you to walk in the authority that he has given you through the power of his name. Amen. This, I give you the keys of the kingdom. Matthew chapter 16. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. My God, you got the power and you got the authority to live a life down here that is victorious. You're the head and not the tail. You're the top and not the bottom. You're more than a conqueror through him that loved you. Glory to God. You don't have to let the devil boss you around, for the Bible says greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Glory to God. You can reign and have victory right now. Oh, I feel like preaching a little here. That's about Joseph. He was in Egypt, commanded in Egypt, but he refused to allow Egypt to get in him. John 17, Jesus said this, verse 16. He prayed and said, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. He was saying, listen, you got to dwell down here and be in this world, but you are not of this world. He told us in John, 1 John 2, verses 15 to 16, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Amen. And so we need to understand that though Joseph was in command and in Egypt, he was still connected to another place. The thing that amazes me about Joseph is with all that he went through, he seemed to remain in an elevated state. He lived above the fray. Now, I don't want to sound arrogant or nothing like that, but as believers, we need to learn how to live above the fray. And watch, to learn that there are some things, some ways of behavior that are beneath us. Mm-hmm. Yeah, touch somebody, tell them that's beneath you. And that's what Joseph had, that mindset. He says, yeah, you threw me in the pit. I'm gonna die here because that's beneath me. In Potiphar's house, when his wife tried to tempt him, he said, no, I'm not going to do that because that's beneath me. In the jail, he says, I'm not going to give anything but excellence on behalf of my God, for the favor of God was upon him. He said, anything else is simply beneath me. When he got on the throne, he said, I'm not going to abuse my power and my authority and punish those who did me wrong. I'm going to forgive, because if I behave like that, that is beneath me. Glory to God. He said, I belong to a different king. I belong to a different system. My flesh wants to do what my flesh wants to do, but my spirit man is telling me that there are some things that I will not do, because that is beneath me. I'm on my way to another place, and I do not belong here. Point number two. Not only must we realize that we cannot be buried because we do not belong here, but number two, don't bury me here, because this is not my promised place. Each and every one of us in here need to understand that we are walking in and living under a promise. Why don't you just look up real quick? I know you see lights, but you need to understand that above your head is a promise from your Father. And you are living under a promise. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now watch. Our goal every day is to wake up and move toward and closer to the vision and the place of promise. You should not be waking up with no purpose. Every day you wake up, shake yourself, and say to yourself, I'm going to spend this day striving to see the fulfillment, watch this, of what God told me and what God showed me. You see, my promise is what he told me, but my vision is what he showed me. I like Abraham, because he demonstrates this to us. Amen. He had a promise from God, and the Bible says that God waited until Abraham was 100 and his wife Sarah was 90, but he always paid attention to what God told him. And in Romans chapter 4, verses 20 through 21, the scripture says, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able to perform. My God. But not only that, but he had a vision of where he was going. For the Bible says in Hebrews that he looked for a city with had foundation, whose builder and maker is God. So this man literally lived his life walking under a promise based on what God had told him and what God had showed him. And you know what? That must have been the force that kept Joseph through all the traumas that he went through. As a matter of fact, it's evident what he is asking for at the end of his life as to what kept him going. He kept going because he was living under the knowledge and walking in, watch this, a multi-generational promise. It was the promise of Abraham. Genesis chapter 12, then the Lord said unto Abraham, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless those that bless you. I'll curse those that curse you. And through you, all the nations of the world shall be blessed. You know something? I believe that based on what Joseph was going through, there had to be some days when he woke up saying, you know what? I don't even know if it's all worth this. Anybody know what I'm talking about? There had to be some days when depression was hanging over him and the enemy was telling him, you know, you need to just give up. Look at you down here in jail. Your family had done you wrong. You're down here suffering and you're hurting. Why don't you just go in that jail cell and take something and hang yourself and give up. Yes, isn't that how the enemy talks to us sometimes? Hey, I'm sorry, I keep forgetting. Y'all have victory every single day of your entire life. Y'all don't have never have a bad day or any sense of depression. Y'all pray for me, because there are some days I wake up and I want to pack my bags and join the circus. Yeah, and Joseph had to have some of those days as he was going through false accusations and going through all kinds of problems. But you know what he understood? He understood that he had a multi-generational promise that was passed on from his father Abraham. And he said, I will not die, I will not quit until that thing comes to pass. You are living under a promise. Turn to somebody, tell them you're living under a promise. As a matter of fact, you need to understand that we're living under a multi-generational promise. Some of y'all sitting in church right now, surprised you're here. Because you got a certain age when you were growing up, and you said, once I get to that age, I ain't never darkening the doors of a church again. But you see, you're under a multi-generational promise, because some of your grandparents and your mama and them were praying for your crazy self so that you can get yourself right. Amen. You wanted to walk away, you wanted to give up, but then God would not let you go, because he heard the prayers of those who have gone before you. Glory to God. And he said, if I gotta break you, if I gotta chase you down, if I got to ruin your life, I'm going to make sure that the promises of your ancestors, I will be upon you. Oh, we used to sing an old song in the church, said my mama prayed for me, had me on her mind, took the time to pray for me. My father prayed for me, had me on his mind, took the time to pray for me. Thank God for the prayers of the saints. Oh, glory to God. Could somebody lift your hands right now and give God a praise? Woo! Glory to God. Hallelujah. I just love that poem that Maya Angelou wrote. And in that poem, she says, it's called Still I Rise. She said, armed with the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the hope and the dream of the slaves. Oh, yes, I'm here right now because somebody somewhere called my name. Glory to God. When I was out of my mind, they said, God, put him in his right mind and put him back on track. When I wanted to walk away and give up, oh, Essie Lee was somewhere calling the name of the Lord. You ought to thank God for a multi-generational promise. Glory to God. Just lift your hands in here one more time and give God a praise. Woo. You see, Joseph, he understood that Egypt was neither his promised place or his future state. And watch what he does. He understands that even with everything he went through, that God preserved him for promise. Even when he died, the Bible says, verse 26, so Joseph died being 110 years old, and they embalmed him. Being in Egypt and being a person in power, Joseph would go through what is called the Egyptian mummification process. In this process, they would take the body and surround it with salt in order to remove the liquid and moisture from the body. Then they would soak the body in spices in order to preserve it. So by the time they got done with old Joe, he was salty. Touch somebody, tell them I'm salty. Jesus said in Matthew 5 and 13, ye are the salt of the earth. And if the salt loses its savor, it's good for nothing. I wonder if I got some salty saints in the house right now. Some of y'all sitting around wondering why some folk don't like you. It's because you're so salty that you, when you get around them, their spirit gets high blood pressure. She burns me up. I can't stand him. Don't even know him, but they don't like you. It's because your salty spirit is attacking the demons that's on the inside of them. And they get high blood pressure soon as you walk into the room. Touch somebody, tell them I'm salty. So the body was embalmed and preserved to be carried into the promised land. Glory to God. Touch somebody else. Tell them I'm well preserved. I'm well preserved. Why? Because God preserved me for promise. Anybody in here thankful that God preserved you for promise? Glory to God. That's why you could not die when you went through the hell that you went through, because God preserved you for promise. Amen. People, the normal person would have had a nervous breakdown after going through what you went through, but God preserved you for promise. Glory to God. Oh, you wanted to die, but something on the inside said, I must live and will not quit until I see this thing come to pass. I've been preserved for promise. Depression tried to take me out and tell me not to get out of bed in the morning, but I got up because I'm preserved for promise. They left me, but they could not break me because I'm preserved for promise. Oh, somebody give God a praise for his keeping power. Woo. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Don't you dare die. Don't you dare give up. Don't you dare walk away until you see those promises and that vision unfold in your life. You've been preserved. High five somebody. Tell him I'm well preserved. Turn to somebody else, tell them, don't bury me here. And the third and final thing, he said, don't bury me here because I don't belong here. Don't bury me here because this is not my place of promise. But the third thing, don't bury me here because my treasure is not here. The word treasure means a deposit. It means hidden riches. Something that is stored for future use. Everybody in here needs to understand that you are a carrier of the treasure of heaven. Turn to somebody real quick and tell them I'm rich. Now, you may not have two nickels to rub together. Maybe broke, busted, and disgusted. Can't afford to pay attention, and all the other phrases. But you're rich. Why? Because God has placed treasure on the inside of you. Talk to me, Paul, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 7. For we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the power may be of God and not we ourselves. God has placed treasure in us. Gifts, talents, abilities, imagination, creativity. Glory to God, you're full of treasure. Now understand that this treasure that you have is designed for kingdom investment and for kingdom purpose. That's why we can't afford to waste our investment on earthly things. Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, Jesus said this, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So if your heart is in the kingdom, your treasure is going to be there as well. And Joseph does something profound concerning his final resting place. He says, take my bones and put them in this casket, coffin. Now understand, when we talk about bones, first of all, in terms of the medical term, the medical field, they're an important part of the human body. They represent the structure of our being. They represent that which provides a dwelling place for our organs and our nerves and our arteries and those things. They are to the body what the foundation of a house would be and what a frame would be to an automobile. Very important. But also understand that in the biblical sense, they're even more important. Because what bones do is they represent the very essence of who we are. They symbolize our inner being in the very core of our existence. As a matter of fact, when a nation was defeated, they would use the term that the bones of that nation were broken. And what they were saying is that the very essence of that nation has been ruined and destroyed. They're the essence of who we are. That's why after God had put Adam to sleep and became his anesthesiologist, and then he became his bone doctor and pulled a bone out of his rib and shaped women all fine and gorgeous. And Adam looked over at his lovely wife and said, baby, you're bone of my bone and you're flesh of my flesh. In other words, I look at you and I see the very essence of who I am. Yes. That is why Jeremiah, when he got ready to quit preaching, he became discouraged. He sat down to write his resignation letter to the bishop to tell him he is done. But then something started happening on the inside. And he said, I wanted to quit. I wanted to give up. But his word was in me and was like fire shut up in my bones. Glory to God. He said, the very essence of who I am has the word of the living God living in me, and it will not let me quit. That's why Ezekiel the prophet was taken up in the spirit and led to a valley of dry bones. And the Bible says he looked and said, lo, they were very dry. And what he was saying is that my nation has fallen away from me and turned to idolatry. And now the very essence of who they are is all dried up. But nevertheless, man of God, I placed a word in you. Prophesy to the bones and cause them to live. Oh, my God. That is why when Jesus was hanging at Calvary, amen, and they came to break his bones. My God, the Bible says by the time the Roman soldier got there that Jesus had given up the ghost. What God was saying is that my son's skin is ripped up on the outside and everything is tore up, but the essence of who he is still intact. My God, he may be dead, but he is still God. Yes, that a bone on his body was broken. So now Joseph is giving them a command. He is saying, I want you to take my bones and place them in this coffin. The essence of who I am, my spirit, my soul that contains the gifts, I want you to put them in this coffin. Can I go a little further? The word coffin in the Hebrew has a very interesting meaning. The word means a mummification chest or a mummy chest, but it also means treasure chest. So Joseph said, take the essence of who I am and put it in this treasure chest, because I do not belong here. Don't bury me here, because this is not where my treasure is. Oh, everything we do, we've got to invest in the kingdom of Almighty God. It's not about you. It's not about me, but it's all about the kingdom. Glory to God. Why? Because I'm preparing, glory to God, that one day this old body is going to expire. This old tabernacle is going to be done. And when I die, they're going to take these bones and drop them off in a treasure chest. But guess what? They ain't gonna stay there because they belong to another world. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. My God, have mercy. I know we don't hear a whole lot of folk preach about heaven, but one day, just like Joseph, amen, I'm gonna enter into my place of promise. My God, one day when the children of Israel reached their promise, they took that casket, that coffin, and carried it into the promised land. They tell me that it was a land flowing with milk and honey. They tell me that it was a land that had houses that they did not build, that had vines that they did not plant. They tell me that it was a land, glory to God, that had wells that they did not dig. Well, I got news for you. One day, should he tarry, if they drop this body in the ground, it's not going to stay there. Glory to God, one day I'm gonna cross the great divide. Oh my God, I know they don't preach about heaven these days, but I still believe in a place called heaven. Oh, glory to God. And one day I'm gonna be dropped in the ground, but it is not going to stay there. I talked to Paul about it, and in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, this is what he told me. He said, brethren, I will not have you to be ignorant concerning them that are asleep, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of Almighty God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we that remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm going to leave this old place. I'm going to shed this old body. Mortal shall put on immortality. Corruptible shall put on corruption. And we shall be changed in the moment of a twinkling of an eye. Oh, glory to God. I'm going to leave here and go to a better place. If y'all don't mind me showing my age, let me tell you what's going to happen. Somebody put it like this. I have a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land. With the blood washed throng, I shall shout and sing, just over in the glory land. Glad hosannas to the Lord and King, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. Ah, there with the mighty dost thou stand. Just over in the glory land. Now join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land. Can I tell you where I'm going? But just in case you look for me, I'm going over yonder to be with my Lord. Glory to God, I'm going to a place where the wicked shall cease from troubling, and the weary shall be at rest, and all of the saints of the ages shall sit at his feet and be blessed. I'm going to a place where the lame man shall leap as a hart, the tongue of the dumb shall sing, where water shall break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. I'm going to a place where we will hear him say, arise and shine, for thy light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon us. I'm going to a place where every day is Sabbath, and the Sabbath had no end. I'm going to a place where the streets are paved with gold. Glory to God, and where I'm going to live. Somebody wrote a song that said, Lord, build me a cabin in the corner of glory. But listen here, I don't even like cabins. Glory to God. He said, I got a mansion for you that's not made by any man. Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. Glory to God. If it were not so, I would have told you. dominion. Yes, we are. They tell me that the patriarchs, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, are going to be there. They tell me that the apostles and the prophets are going to be there. I don't know about you, but I got a mother on the other side that I'm looking forward to see. Yes, they're going to be there, but more than that, I want to see the guest of honor. I want to see the one that I live for. Somebody called him the Rose of Sharon. Somebody called him the Lily of the Valley. Somebody called him the Bright and Morning Star. Somebody called him my King. Somebody called him the Rock. Somebody called him a Fortress. Somebody called him a Deliverer. He's my Savior, my Sanctifier, my Holy Ghost Baptizer. He's the fragrance of a thousand gardens, pressed into one springtime. He's my hope. He's my joy. He's my peace. You can call him what you call him, but I call him Jesus. Oh, yeah. Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. I'm going to look upon his face. God said, beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. I want to look upon his face. I want to see him for myself. So as I journey through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my side, from without, within. I gotta stop, but my Lord leads me on. Through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him. Woo. Oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face. People around you, tell them, don't bury me here. No. Oh, yeah. I feel the Holy Ghost in this house right now. Yes. Woo! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift your hands to heaven. Hallelujah. So what are you singing? What are you singing? Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the hope that lies within us. Thank you for the fact that we're strangers, just passing through. Somebody today, God, the enemy's been trying to bury them in the wrong places, trying to bury them under discouragement and depression, trying to bury them under the pain of this life, trying to bury them under betrayal and rejection. But we declare to this world, we declare to that devil that we will not be buried here. We shall live and not die, and declare the glory and the wonderful works of our God. I speak resurrection power all over this house right now. I speak life to visions and dreams and hope and spirits, Father. I declare today that you would just touch my brothers and sisters right now. Thank you for hope. Release it all over this house today, God. In the name of Jesus. Bless them, Father. In the name of Jesus. Can I pray for somebody today? First of all, I want you to know that the place called heaven that I preached about is a gift of eternal life. Jesus died for your sins so that you could have it. And if you are here and you do not know him, I want to register you for heaven today. If you'd like to be saved, can I pray for you? Where are you? Where are you? Somebody would say, preacher, I am saved, but I got to confess the enemy has been trying to bury me. Some of you have lost hope. Some of you are just going through the motions, and you need to tell the devil today, I refuse to be buried here. I'm not going to be buried in this event. I'm not going to be buried in this trial. Make your way to this altar. We want to pray for you today. Come on. Come on. Step out. Come on. Yes, Lord. Come on. I will not be buried here. No. Nuh-uh. God wants to break the spirit of discouragement and hopelessness. Come on. Step out. Come on, come on, come on. Yes, Lord. God wants to know. God is asking.
I can take no pain. The heartaches they bring, the comfort in knowing I'll soon be gone. As God gives me grace, I'll run this race
until I see my Savior.
Glory out.
Thank you, Jesus. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus.
Sing His mercy.
Happy 60th anniversary. All right. God bless you. Amen. Don't forget, our men's ministry is going to be meeting Saturday at noon here at the church. 10 o'clock, I'm sorry, 10 o'clock. All right, 10 o'clock. Our men's meeting will be in the administrative building. And ladies as well. All right, so our men and women will be meeting this coming Saturday. Amen. I want to give somebody an opportunity. Maybe you've been coming to church here for a while. Amen. You've been dating us. Time to put a ring on it. You'd like to join this morning? Would you just lift your hand? We want to get you into our... All right. Bless you. Come on up. Come on forward. Amen. Somebody else? Right. Praise the Lord. You can come on forward, please. All right. Amen. Isn't God good? All right. Don't forget little man over here. Taking up the rear.
Amen. Welcome.
Hello, everyone. My name is Randy Laws. This is my beautiful wife, Chantel Laws, and our son, Renoy Laws. We're Jamaican. We're new to the area.
Where from?
Jamaica. All right, so we're new to the area, and we came here, I think it was, Easter? Yeah, it was a beautiful service.
Praise God.
And we were hooked. And my wife, she got pregnant, and this is our third time here, and we would love to be a part of the family. Thank you.
All right. Praise the Lord. You'll just follow this handsome gentleman right here. He is going to get you. And get you into our new members class. Amen. God is good, isn't he? Amen. Let's lift our hands. Father, thank you again for the hope that lies in us. Let us live. Let us walk. Let us fellowship and treat each other as people of hope. Bless your people this week. Be with them. Give them the blessed, a blessed and best week that they've ever had. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.